Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for gathering us together this evening to be in the presence of your Son. For he has promised us, when two or three are gathered in his name, there he is against us. So we welcome you, Lord Jesus. And we glorify and praise you. Thank you that you live. And that because you live, we will live also. And now, Lord Jesus, we pray that in your mercy you would send forth your Holy Spirit to fill each and every one of our hearts. Open our eyes to see and our ears to hear and our hearts to receive from you today. And we pray, Lord, that you would just plant your word deeply in our hearts and bear fruit for your whole life. And now, Lord, I pray that the words of my mouth and meditations of our hearts be truly acceptable in your sight, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Thank you. Grace and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, during Easter, we have been discussing what the resurrection means for us as far as personally, but also what the resurrection means with regards to our ministry to others. And today, what we see is this, that the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ means very clearly that Jesus is the only way to heaven. He is the only way to eternal life. He is the only way that we can enter into a right relationship with the Father and have salvation and have eternity of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit now and forever. He's the only way. For we read in 1 John chapter 5 the following. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. The resurrection proves that this word is true. Now, I understand very clearly that this is not a popular teaching. It's not something our world likes to hear. Unfortunately, it's even true there are people in the church who don't like to hear this. We like to believe that as long as we're nice people and good people, we don't kick the cat, we pay our taxes, we should end up in heaven. And we're a society that tends to want to think that it doesn't matter what religion you are, as long as you're good, nice people, you'll make it. But that's not what the Lord says. That's not what the Bible witnesses to. That's not what the cross means. And that is not what the resurrection indicates. So let me explain why it is that it's not true that all we always lead to heaven. Only Jesus opens that door for you and for me and for everyone. You see, one of the things we need to remember is this. Our Lord Jesus was very clear about the exclusive nature of his ministry and his sacrifice. He said in John 14, verse 6, the following. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. When he used the definite article, the, he was saying essentially, I am the only way, the only truth, the only life. There is no other way into the graces of the Father except through Jesus. Now, why is that so? Why is it true? Well, for that, we need to remember what Jesus came for. We read in the Gospel of John, but we see it in other places throughout the Gospels and throughout the letters and throughout the Old Testament. We read this. John the Baptist said of Jesus, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. With that one proclamation, John the Baptist was telling us a couple of things about Jesus and about ourselves that we need to remember. The first thing we need to remember is this. Jesus has come to take away the sins of the world. The one thing we need to remember is that everyone on earth has one similarity. All of us have a sin problem in our lives. In fact, we find that in Isaiah 53, verse 6. In Isaiah 53, verse 6, we read this. All we like sheep have gone astray, everyone to his own way. Now, let me tell you, I've said this before, but I'll say it again just to be sure that we all heard it. When I did a word study on the word all, guess what it means? all. It means there are no exceptions. Doesn't matter if you're black, white, brown, yellow, red, green, purple, or blue. Doesn't matter what color you are. Doesn't matter what nation you're from. Doesn't matter if you're a man or a woman. Doesn't matter how old you are. Everyone has within them that orientation to go and do their own thing. God has His way, but we're going to do it my way. And as soon as we decide I'm going to do it my way, we are in rebellion. We're in sin. We're in lawlessness. And God says in Isaiah this, He said, your ways are not my way. So when we're not following God, we are automatically in rebellion. What that also means is this, and it's something we need to get deep into our spirit so that we can understand how important the sacrifice of Jesus is. You see, a lot of people think, well, you know, I'm not a murderer, and I haven't committed adultery, and I pay my taxes, I don't cheat people, so I should be okay. And we tend to think about sin as being those things that make the paper. Murder, adultery, bank robbery, or things of that nature. But what we find in the Bible is that God, although those are all sins, God actually thinks that sin is also those things that don't make the paper. You see, you may not be an adulterer. You may never have committed murder. You may never have cheated on your taxes. You may never have robbed a bank, praise the Lord. You may not have gotten drunk. That's awesome. But whatever you have said in your life, I'm going to do it my way, not God's way. My way. I'm going to compromise with God's word and do it this way because it's easier. What are you? A sinner. I'm not pointing to anyone in particular. I've done that myself. All of us are guilty of cutting corners and saying, I'm going to do it my way. That makes us a rebel. And it also means that, you know what, you can be the nicest person on the face of the earth. But if you said, I'm going to do it my way at any time, you're just as guilty as the person that committed murder. In the eyes of God, you're just as guilty. Because what are the wages of sin? The wages of sin is death. That's true for the murderer. That's true for the bank robber. That's true for the one who decided to gossip. That's true for the one who wanted to tell a little white lies. It's true for all of us. What that means then is that none of us can say, I am so guilt-free and so sin-free that my works will make me right before God. In fact, we find in the Bible this very verse. By works of the law shall no one be made right before God. Why? Well, in Isaiah 64, we read this. All of our good deeds or our righteous deeds are as filthy rags. The reason for that is not because good deeds are bad, they're wonderful. But God's standards are so high that you and I, by our own works, could never reach that standard. We could never reach that height. Therefore, we are never going to meet the perfection that God demands for holiness and for a right relationship with Him. That means that unless somebody does something on our behalf, we are all going to hell. We're all hell bound. Because we can't get ourselves right with God. We can't do it on our own. Somebody else has to do it for us. And praise God, somebody did. God so loved the world, that's your thing, that He sent His only begotten Son. Jesus came to be the Lamb who sacrificed on our behalf. He went to the cross and paid our penalty. He paid the debt that we owe. God's justice, God's wrath that would rightly come upon us, fell on Jesus. As we read in Isaiah 53, verse 6b, the Lord has laid on Him, Jesus, the iniquity of us all. So all the evil that was due to us because of our sin fell on Him. And all the good that was due to him because of his sinless life comes to us. That Jesus died on the cross means that our sin issue has been taken care of. God has taken care of it. He has paid the penalty for you and for me. Praise the Lord. Praise God for that. But you know what? Jesus is the only one who's done that for you. Muhammad did not die for you. Buddha did not die for you. No other figure on the earth at any time ever did that for you. Only Jesus is the God-given Lamb sent from heaven to do what we could not do, deal with our sin issue. But then the question becomes this: how do we know that it's really dealt with? Because Jesus says he came to deal with it. He said on the cross, it's finished, paid in full, should be taken care of. But if he doesn't rise from the dead, he's a liar. Because he said he was going to rise on the third day. But when God the Father raised him up, God the Father declared to the world that that sacrifice that was made on your behalf and mine has been accepted by him. Therefore, as far as God's concerned, you and I and every person on the face of the earth can now have a right relationship with the Father and have eternal life because of what Jesus did. All that needs to happen is we need to appropriate it by faith. Trust in what he's done, surrender our lives to Jesus, and we have what he's promised. The resurrection proves that that sacrifice has been accepted and those who have the Son have life. That's what it means. Those who have the Son have eternal life. And again, let me just say this. Muhammad did not rise from the dead. You go see his tomb today, he's still in it. Buddha has not been raised from the dead. You go check out his tomb too. He's still there. So is Confucius. So is every other religious figure. But you can show up at Jesus' tomb any time you like, and there's nobody there. No one. Why? Because he's alive. He's alive and ascended into heaven. He's the only one that God ever raised from the dead and said, this sacrifice is accepted for the whole world. So the resurrection declares to you and to me and to the whole world that the atoning sacrifice has been accepted and salvation is available to everyone who would put their faith in what the Lord Jesus Christ has done. But now, what does that mean for the ministry of the church? For you and for me? Well, what it means very, very clearly is this. It says again, whoever has the Son has life, and whoever does not have the Son does not have life. What that means is that if we know that Jesus is Lord and we have received his salvation, our job is to go out and find people who don't know it and let them know. Because it is not the will of the Father that anyone should perish, but that all should be saved. We find in Ezekiel that the Father says, look, I do not desire the death of anyone. Repent, therefore, and live. After his resurrection, our Lord Jesus, we find this in the Gospel of Matthew, the 28th chapter, in the 18th verse, our Lord Jesus, after his resurrection, talks to his disciples and says this, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations. Baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teach them to observe everything that I've commanded you, and lo, I am with you always to the end of the age. Jesus got up out of the grave and spent 40 days with these disciples to get them prepared to do what? To get out and let the world know that salvation is available. He doesn't want anyone missing out on the opportunity to get right with the Father and be saved from the fires of hell. Because if they don't have the Lord, that is where they go. And his desire is that human beings should not enter into hellfire, but enter into the dominion and the inheritance that he intended from the very beginning. Hellfire, by the way, was never intended for human beings. Do you know that? It was intended for the unholy angels. We were never intended to go there. But we will if we don't know the Lord and don't receive His atoning sacrifice. So today, let us remember that the resurrection means that that sacrifice is accepted, and it means that Jesus is the way that God has ordained for the salvation of every man, woman, and child. But it also means this, that because we know that, we cannot compromise on that message, and we cannot sit there and pat people on the head and say, well, okay, you can just go your own way and we hope you get there. No. We need to let them know the good news of Jesus Christ and they can turn to Him and get saved. Because as St. Peter said in Acts, there is no other name given among men by which we may be saved. Let's not compromise on the word. Because in my mind, as I'm looking at what the way the world's going right now, we do not have long. And the Lord will return. That's my opinion. And therefore, I think we need to be extra vigilant to make sure that we are sharing our faith with others so that they end up ready to receive the Lord with thanksgiving rather than receiving when it comes with fear and with the expectation of judgment. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, we'll sing our next hymn. It's 143, the red hymn.